one, navigator. Burn all speaker ones now. Keep quiet, it's okay.
Over 6,000 men and women from the Caribbean joined the RAF during World War II, many of whom served as pilots, navigators, engineers, and ground crew. We're at Biggin Hill, and we're going to be talking to historian and author Maureen Dickson, who's researched the lives of some of these remarkable men. The Heritage Spitfire hangar at Biggin Hill is a remarkable tribute to aviation history. It houses meticulously restored Spitfires. It was the perfect place to catch up with Maureen. Right, so that's the sound of a Spitfire that's just taking off here at Biggin Hill. Maureen, it's been amazing so far, hasn't it?
Yes, indeed.
I'm like a kid in a toy shop walking around these amazing aircraft. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about yourself and what inspired you to write that superb book of yours.
So my thing was, why did my father have a ration book? And Britain was over there and Guyana was over here. So that's what kicked it off.
Wow. Mm. So what's the figure? 6,000 Caribbean men and women joined the Royal Air Force?
Yes, it was 6,000, of which 500 were air crew. So they were pilots, navigators, gunners, that sort of thing. And they only chose the cream of the crop. Now we know this because of the jobs they took on afterwards. Yeah. You know, there was two prime ministers, things. People like Cy Grant, who wrote loads of books and also was an actor, and he actually acted with Richard Burton and Joan Collins in a film called Sea Wife. They were barristers, Ulric Cross. Ulric Cross flew 80 sorties over Germany, and he is the most highly decorated Caribbean pilot.
Wow. And now you went across the Caribbean to trace these stories.
Yes.
How long did it take you to do that then, Maureen?
Well, my research altogether took 6 years.
Wow.
In and out doing bits and pieces, and I travelled about 4 times to the Caribbean. It's very little known that before the Americans came into the war, Trinidad was a sort of hub. So it had 5 bases on it and 2 naval bases, one of which was a submarine base. And also it had a military hospital. So if you were hurt in any of the theatres of war, you would be sent to Trinidad, you'd be patched up, and they would decide at that point whether to send you back on the front line or to send you home. So it wasn't surprising that the people who came from Trinidad could fly, because there was a flying school there. And you would have seen, as a young man, you would have seen all these planes and all these people in uniform and everything else. So you wouldn't have hesitated to join the Air Force or the Army.
So is that where, through your research, is that where they learned to fly the Spitfire, or did they have to?
No, what happened was there was an agreement between Canada, Australia, Britain, that people who wanted to fly and who were actually in the air service went to Canada to be trained. And then they came back and were sort of like polished off, and then they were decided where they should be. Mm. And what they actually did was they'd have a special evening and they'd have everybody in one room. Mm. So you'd have the navigator, you'd have the pilot, the gunner, whatever. And the pilot would go around and talk to everyone in every discipline that he needed to fly his Lancaster, for instance. And then he would choose. And for the Spitfire, that was slightly different because they went through a slightly different process because they were flying on their own.
Yeah. Wow. How were they treated, Maureen? When they came into the UK, you've got predominantly white Royal Air Force then. Any difficulties when the pilots took to the air in the Spitfire?
I found that the pilots and people in general of the RAF don't really talk about that. Okay. It's more the army. But the fact of the matter was that 1939 was very important. Yeah, A, the war broke out. Mm. B, conscription was made. 18 to 41 chaps had to go. And also that was a period when King George VI had said, look, we need to go to the Caribbean and actually get some more people over here, because he was really afraid that he would lose the war, because he'd lost a lot of people in France and also in Battle of Britain. So although it was 1939 that the colour bar was taken down, it wasn't until 1941, 1942 that you actually see them being taken on and getting their wings and actually being able to fly. So there was a gap, although there was like 18 months or 2 years to actually train a pilot. Battle of Britain, they didn't have that long. They just needed to shove them out as quick as possible. So that's really what the situation was. And some of them say, yes, there was a lot of racism. I think it's a thing of, if there's one of you, it's okay. If there's more of you, then there seems to be a problem.
Wow.
Yeah.
What happened to them when the war ended? Where did the pilots go? Any knowledge?
Well, they were told that they could stay and that they could live here. I mean, why not? They had British passports, they spoke British. Mm. You know, they were told that Britain was a mother country. Mm-hmm. Why would they not join and fight, you know? So they felt that they could stay, but quite a lot of them was told, no, you have to go back home. And when they went back home, of course, they'd lost their jobs because they took the job of being a pilot or whatever here, so they'd lost their jobs over there. And they were used to different things also. We can't hide that. So they couldn't settle. So a lot of them suffered. Now, some of them were told, we'll give you a pension or we'll give you some land.
Yeah.
And they did have land, but it was way in the interior where it wasn't much good. Mm. So that's why a lot of them decided to come back on the Windrush, because there just wasn't any jobs for them.
Arrivals at Tilbury. The Empire Windrush brings to Britain 500 Jamaicans. Many are ex-servicemen who know England. They serve this country well. In Jamaica, they couldn't find work. Discouraged but full of hope, they sailed for Britain. Citizens of the British Empire coming to the mother country with good intent.
And you wrote your book?
Yes, indeed.
And it's in Waterstones, I believe. So we'll put a link to the film where you can buy your book.
Okay.
Right, Maureen, I don't know about yourself, but I really enjoyed this morning.
Yes, I did too. It's very informative, nice atmosphere. Yeah. And it's always good to be able to see things in situ rather than just read about them, you know, so that was really good.
I've never been near a Spitfire before. I've never seen one take off. I thought it was absolutely fantastic.
Yes, that was great. I have seen one before, I must admit, but I've never seen it actually with people getting into it. I've seen it in the air as well, on a flypast, a bomber command. Mm. So it was nice to get sort of close up personal, as it were, with it. It was quite enjoyable.
Brilliant. Let's go back to your book you wrote.
The whole reason I started the book, apart from talking to my father, was because I felt passionate about the fact that there were so few people who knew that there were people of colour who actually fought in World War I and World War II.
Yeah.
And the book is not just a book of facts and figures, but actual people, actual stories of experiences that people had. So that's why it's really important. The other thing is, I'm always hearing people say, well, you know, black children don't have any role models. And there are loads of role models out there, but it's just that they're not talked about. And this is the problem. Mm. And there's loads of role models, such as Ulrich Cross, for instance, you know, who flew 80 sorties over enemy territory. He was shot down 7 times.
Wow.
But he survived, you know, and became a judge. He became Attorney General afterwards. So those are people that I'm trying to get over to the young people as well, to say, well, look, if you have a dream, don't say, oh, it's impossible. It's not impossible. Go for it, because it's all there to play for.
And just finally, how important is Black History Month?
I think it's important, but do you know what? I think that it shouldn't just be 1 month, because history isn't just consigned to 1 month. Mm. History is every day.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, at some point we need to get out of this, oh, it's just History Month and it's all right, we'll all sort of subscribe to that for that month and then forget about it for the rest of the year. I think it's something that's ongoing. Because not only did these young men and women from the Caribbean come over to fight, they went home and they came back again to build the infrastructure of Britain. And I think not enough people realize that. Or if they do, maybe they don't realize to what extent or to what sacrifices were made in order to do that. So I think that we should look at it on a broader picture, broader level in regards to that.
Maureen Dickson, you are an inspiration. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Arm doors open. 25.